Welcome to our Passenger Zoom issue launch. My name is Kendra Kopelke, and I am a passenger editor. The issue we're celebrating is very special. The focus is generational trauma. We want to thank the writers who joined us today to read their work. We're honored by your presence. Thank you for trusting Passenger with your stories. The issue is guest edited by Chris Lincoln, an internationally award-winning author and former poet laureate of York, Pennsylvania. In South Africa, she was the first author to represent the United States in South Africa's annual Year of the Writer celebration. She has appeared on NPR, The Oprah Winfrey Show, and has been featured as a phenomenal woman in O, the Oprah magazine. Beyond Chris's phenomenal literary accomplishments, she is a deep listener, a deep reader, a loving healer, and a cherished friend. Anyone who has had the good fortune to work with her knows that to be in her world is to be enriched and changed. She lifts people up wherever she goes. We're honored to have her with us today. Take it away, Chris Lincoln.
Thank you, Kendra. When Kendra and the Passenger team asked me to be the guest editor for this issue, I knew right away that it would be an issue about trauma. We were, as a nation, still very much reeling from the trauma of the pandemic, well, as the world really. And so we were in this process, this state of trying to recover ourselves. And I knew that I wanted to tackle that head on. That was the first thing that I knew. But I also knew that I wanted to do more than just create a collection. I wanted to gather a multiverse of voices, but that we would be one voice, one song, a real universe, which means one poem. And so that's what I wanted us to create: one story, one poem, one song. And the opening note of that song was crucial. And when Kendra and I, sitting in the middle of the floor with Gracie Allen, after a day of trying to figure out the order of this work that we were, this baby that we were trying to birth, when we decided and discovered that the opening note of this book would be my conception, it shifted everything. I'll tell you, my conception, it is brutal. It's raw. It's brutal. It just is. It turns the whole notion of giving birth like on its head, really. But it really speaks to, for me, the human existence, because we are all born into a body of suffering. You know, we're all born with hearts and limbs that will be broken. And so to start the issue with that, it was taking a risk, but when you get to the end of the book with the poem, The Story That Keeps, we find ourselves, despite all of that, standing on the side of a mountain. And yes, grief is still there, but grief is singing. It's singing. And everything, every poem, every essay, every story that has come between those two moments has brought us to that place. It's a healing place. It's a place of recovery. Diane Oatley actually says in her piece, Bomb Proof, I want to read a book that explains me to myself. And I feel like all of you have done that. We've created a book that explains us. It explains our human existence here. That yes, we will have trauma, we will suffer, we will be broken, but that when we get to the other side, it's a song and we will be singing. So I just want to thank all of you for everything that you've done to help us to birth this baby. And here it is.
The story of Carol Ann you're about to hear is seared indelibly in my heart and influenced me to become a teacher and to work in a crisis center. After I retired, I designed and now teach Writing Through the Rough Spots, a class for people to create clarity about life challenges through writing. My first full-length collection of poems will be released in May by Antrim Books, and Carol Ann is in it. She sits at the desk in front of me. One. She sits at the desk in front of me, turns around again, grinning, and tells me something funny, and we laugh. Still grinning, she tells me that her daddy is in jail. Greasy strands of hair hang around her face. Carol Ann, how many times do I have to tell you not to turn around? Mrs. Armstrong asks, but isn't really asking. Two. Mrs. Armstrong runs a strict third grade. Every morning, first thing, we all stand up to look at the flag on the pointy stick and put our right hands on our hearts and say the pledge and the prayer. One day, when we enter the classroom, our mouths make O's when we see Carol Ann. We stand for the pledge and the prayer. Almighty God, we acknowledge our dependence upon thee and beg thy blessings upon us, our parents, our teachers, and our country. Amen. A large piece of duct tape covers Carol Ann's mouth. Three. At supper, Mom tells us about the call she got from Mrs. Armstrong. It's kind of you to think of us for the clothing from your niece, but we have enough. What about giving them to someone who needs them like Carol Ann? Mom asked. She wouldn't appreciate them, Mrs. Armstrong said. But soon we get a box of patent leather shoes, turquoise taffeta skirt, white ruffled ankle socks, red velvet dress with a white lace collar. I wear blue jeans to school and don't like any of these things anyway. Mom already had to go to the principal's office about that. Her marks are good if she's not a behavior problem. Why can't she wear blue jeans? And it turns out that I can. So it isn't hard for me to be generous. We take the box of clothes to Carol Ann's house. Well, it isn't a house, really. It's above Vogler's garage with the truck that empties our septic tank. She lives with her grandma, who is missing some teeth, but she's nice and invites us in. My mom sits at the kitchen table. Carol Ann's grandma puts out two cups. The room smells like old lady armpits and onions. Carol Ann takes me down the hall to a room with bunk beds. We sit on the edge of one of them and play cat's cradle with a string and make cootie catchers. Five. The next day, Carol Ann brings a green glass bottle of Coke to school. Mrs. Armstrong says this is very bad. So to let her know how bad it is, and to make sure she doesn't turn around in her desk, talk, or get up and move around the classroom, Mrs. Armstrong ties her in her chair with a rope. Under the Palmer Method alphabet, hanging up high on the wall above our eyes in the classroom, I learn and never ever forget the meanings of good and bad, of right and wrong. Now I would like to introduce our next reader, Christine O'Leary Rockey.
Well, Alan, thank you for reading that. That was profound. My parents always took a family portrait every year. And the year that my father decided to go, she decided to do it anyway. I guess she was trying to retain some sort of normalcy. And that, of course, is in between the rage fits and hospitalizations and all sorts of great fun stuff. And I was struck by the photo when I saw it and I wrote this piece. The photo was, it was just her and three kids and the new family dog. She had gotten a dog when he left, decided to protect the house, but he was mostly kept chained in a garage and newspaper and blanket. But he was my best friend at the time, and I got to hold him during the picture. The poem is called Portrait of My Mother. She's thin in that picture. I can see her skull through the flesh of her cheeks, eyes straight and stalks through living bone. She's holding my hand. She stares like she's looking at something. It cannot be that photographer, not unless she's contemplating killing it. You never look at someone like that without the intent to do harm, especially not your children. Thank you very much. Thank you for including me in the issue, and thank you everyone for being here. The next reader up is Tonia Dixon.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's an honor to be here as well. When I was introduced to an opportunity to submit to Passenger, I was reading all about Love, New Visions by Bell Hooks. And she just enraptured me with this particular passage, and I had to mull it over and over in the book. And it says, often children will want to remain with parental caregivers who have hurt them because of their catholic feelings for those adults, usually by denying the abuse and focusing on random acts of care. And when I read that passage, it grabbed me in a way that my upbringing and the abuse and the domestic violence was something that was a part of my story, but it was not a part of my story that I shared, nor was I willing to share. And then my mother passed. She passed during the COVID-19. She passed. And when she passed and I saw the submission open, this poem just downloaded, and I sketched the poem. And for the first time, I said, okay, I have to tell my story. And it's called Spoil the Children. She was continuously on a witch hunt, looking for proof that we warrant her whip across our bodies. We counted the whips left over from her obeying the scripture to keep us from wandering, unblemished by pleasures, for missing curfews, discovering kisses, leaving the gate unlatched, or because the towels were left on the clothesline in the rainstorm. These minor infractions did not warrant the burn of bruises, the passing of witch hazel from hand to hand to soothe the physical pain. But the emotional injuries did not stop us from shaking the stick at our own children. We did not use the slaver's tools for insurrection. Instead, belts and broomsticks became our weapons for bringing correction to our children. Fear raised us all instead of affection. Like love made us too soft for the harsh reality of being Southern Blacks. So we prepared for the world's injustices at home. Our next reader is Terri Steel.
Hello, everyone. I am so honored to be among the wonderful artists here today. Thank you. I'm going to read from my essay, We Can All Get a Little Crazy, and I'm going to begin from the beginning and just do a short excerpt. I was drowning. I was 5 years old and in an above-ground pool with my parents and their friends who had invited us over for a cookout. It had been great fun at first. Too short to reach the bottom, I held onto the side as my mother had instructed, circling the outer edge as I bobbed up and down, dipping my head under along the way until I became locked beneath the surface. My eyes wide, I struggled to break free, but felt the same resistance. It was my father's hand. He had been dunking me for a long while, allowing me a gulp of air in between submersions, but not enough to catch a full breath before plunging me back down. I heard laughter and his friend's warning the last time I had broke the water's surface. "Jesus, Frank, you're going to kill her." "Aw, I'm just having a little fun is all," Dad said, pushing me back under. Stephen, my little brother, joined me in the struggle. His head plunged suddenly in front of mine, looking like a panicked blowfish, his cheeks puffed out, his eyes bulging. Another hand held him down. I couldn't tell if it belonged to my father or his friend George. The two men had been drinking all day, so I thought we would probably die. I couldn't bear to look at Stephen. He didn't have much longer. His limbs were slowing down and going limp. He was only 3 years old. I knew to stay out of my father's way, grabbing up Stephen and hiding in a closet whenever his voice thundered through our house, our bodies huddled together in the back behind his suits, sitting on rows of Dad's polished shoes as he went after our older brother, Mike. Mike was the main target. My father liked to beat him with a wire, mostly. That's what he called it. It was actually a cord attached to the electrical skillet Mom cooked pancakes on. Dad would pull it off its metal prongs and whip Mike with it until my brother had enough. "Have you had enough yet?" my father would ask, his sweat beading on his flushed forehead. Mike would hold out as long as he could. Sometimes he held out too long until the wire drew blood. Stephen and I were usually the lucky ones, avoiding Dad's brutality. He hated Mike the most. We all knew that. Mike and Dad rarely got along. I often found myself wondering what my brother had done to deserve such hatred, but I think it may have been the fact that he didn't look and act like Dad. Where Dad was slim, Mike was husky. Where Dad fumed red when he got angry, Mike stared calmly and smirked as if he knew a secret. It was almost as if Mike were the older of the two. I was Dad's favorite. The dunking in the pool was the first time I was his target, unless you count the time he knocked the wind out of me when he threw me a football. But he swore that was an accident. Mom didn't believe him, but I did. It came at me like a bullet, hitting me in the middle of my chest and throwing me back on the grass. I couldn't breathe then either, but Mom was there to stroke my head and calm me down, explaining that I just had the air knocked out of me. I hoped she would save me from my father this time too, but it appeared I was on my own. Mom complained that Dad had two distinct personalities. She often referred to him as Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. I never knew which one to pray for because I would get the two mixed up and didn't want to call forth the wrong one. And now I would like to introduce Claire Kahane. Thank you.
I'm a retired English professor, now writing about those moments that still remain alive in my long memory. Today, I'm reading an excerpt from Cats Go For Your Throat, which focuses on my early childhood, and especially on my mother, an immigrant from Russia who was generally sensitive to the pain of others because of her own traumatic childhood. But, as I wrote, but my mother had a temper too, and often lost it violently. On those occasions, she went straight for whatever object was at hand, a glass, a toy, flinging it at the source of her exasperation, most often me, a jar of milk. Because one afternoon I didn't want to drink my milk, a daily ritual of nurturance that she imposed, she threw the jar of milk in my face with such force that it broke my front tooth. Tough love. Nurturance, so often unbound. My mother's hand holding a spoon, trying to force it into my mouth, which remained clamped shut. First came the blandishments, then the threats. "You can have a jelly candy if you eat this first. I'll give you a sweet. I'll give you a pudding." Melodious offerings. My mother's voice singing to me, while the spoon held by her hand remained rigidly in front of my mouth, waiting for an opening. And if the sweet talk didn't work? Listen, if you don't open up, I'll send you to the home for orphans. Listen, she said. I listened. A dream from early childhood. I am in my baby carriage, and my mother is pushing the carriage toward the end of the block on which we live, which is at the top of a big hill. When she gets to the corner, she pushes the carriage with great force so that it hurtles down the hill. I huddle inside, terrified. Love was especially tough between my parents. Each seemed always under siege by the other, the two of them shouting in the bedroom in Yiddish, one on each side of the big bed that took up most of the room. My father throwing out a torrent of curses at my mother, she throwing them back. What fierce storms they generated, thunder and lightning crashing around the room as they hurled invectives at each other, while I, at age 2, 3, 4, cowered under the bed, trying to keep a safe distance. You Halalia, you! The fiercest insult hurled back and forth. Halalia, pestilence. Would we all survive this pestilence? Memory broke open the door to another stormy argument between them that suddenly stopped when my mother shouted, enough! I'm not staying with such a Halalia. Rushing to the bedroom, she pulled a suitcase from the closet, tore open the bureau drawers, and wild with frustration, threw clothes into the open case, slammed it shut, grabbed my hand, and dragged me out of the front door of our second floor apartment and down the stairs. No, 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 I don't want to go, I screamed, sputtering, no, 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 crying, coughing, and choking on my own spittle, the storm now in my head, tears blurring my vision, until one flight down, my mother finally turned to look at me, and then, just as suddenly, as if afraid of what she saw, she stopped, hugged me to her breast, saying, all right, we'll go back. With a surge of relief, my four-year-old heart still pounding, I stumbled back up the stairs, holding my mother's hand, back to the apartment, back to my father, back to the only world I knew. And our next reader is Christina Robertson. Christina?
Thank you, Claire. Thank you, everybody. I'm really happy to be part of this. My story, short story, The Immunity of Milkmaids, was originally written as one part of a bookended pair within a story collection. The other piece concerns a psychotic patient's desperation for validation. In Milkmaids, I sought to reveal the therapist's personal journey, also one of damage, sacrifice, and hope. I was interested in how her character is compelled, and that neither she nor her patient are fully aware of how closely their needs and desires resemble each other's. You tell yourself so many times that you're not special just because your father's breath makes your room smell bad like whiskey and defeat when he opens the door at night and watches you as you pretend to sleep. You're certainly not the only one whose parents threaten to leave each other. It's no big deal because when sober, your father may actually be kind of okay, funny, cool. May call you Paulina Piccolo and draw pictures for you. He may tell you stories about tiny plastic soldiers fighting the good fight in the tall summer grass of his youth, about quests and holy grails, underestimated heroes, melancholy golden-haired damsels in distress. You probably know somehow in your little girl brain that he needs these stories even more than you do, so you let him tell them over again. You probably play along, just happy he's home, not leaving or being left, not too drunk, not too mean. He'll share some of the funny things he knows then, and you love that. Say, how some birds build nests in the cruelest, most forbidding thorn bushes, or how beautiful shades of paint often come from toxic elements, or how smallpox was cured by milkmaids. In the telling, he will likely twist a few things leave out details that don't serve his general purpose or he isn't entirely clear on. He will only say something like, a long way back, it had been observed that farm girls who worked milking dairy cows every day didn't seem to be falling ill with the smallpox, while it had become a terrible epidemic within the general population. Mystery revealed, he'll say. It turns out that as they toiled beside the docile beasts, touching their soft udders, sharing breath, taking in stride all their foul, steamy emissions, these girls had been repeatedly exposed to a similar but less deadly virus, cowpox, and contracting that had, in its way, rendered them immune. In the day, this observation offered further substance to the emerging scientific notion that inoculating people with a small dose of virus, one they could fight off, could effectively protect them from a more lethal intruder. Thus, it came to light a viable solution to the ravages of smallpox, or so he'll proclaim. It was also the birth of the word vaccine, he'll note, taken from vaca, cow. He'll throw that in, hoping to sound erudite. And he knows you're fond of animals. You still like to think about this, about the simplicity, the simple power and beauty of it. That an invaluable pearl took shape in a shit-filled barn, and about young girls as more than fragile, more than simply subjugates, mascots, Swiss misses, rather girls as mothers of invention, as harbingers of a cure, they were elevated from benign girlhood and its ribbons and presumptive apple-cheeked innocence, its inherent underwhelm. You always seem to be somewhere on this path yourself, trying to evolve out of daughterhood, Paulinehood, some empty emblematic ideal, the princess in the tower or some such thing. You sense by giving yourself, by tapping the deep vein of your troubles, the blood of your pain will help others survive and perhaps elevate you in the process. Our next reader is Gail Arnoff.
Thanks, Christina. When memories of abuse first surfaced in my 30s, I learned to call myself a survivor. In my 60s, I began writing a memoir. Now that I've been published in a number of journals, I consider myself to be a writer. Today, on my 79th birthday, I am so proud to be part of this writing community. Thanks, Passenger. I'm going to read some excerpts from a piece called Leaving Daddy Alone. His thick, calloused fingers magically transform into soft feathers as they tickle my back. In a slightly husky voice, he cajoles, "How about a front rub?" Something tells me to wriggle my way off his lap, to escape those hands and the little shivers which pulse through my body when he reaches under my shirt. Even his, "Come on, Grace Kelly," cannot tempt me, at least not until the next time. Too often, need wins out, and there I am, perched on his lap, at age 6, 10, 14, 17, craving a hug or an I love you from my mother, I settle for daddy's touch. I load my little brother into his tailor tot and then count my steps as I push him 5 houses up the street, 5 houses back. I need to stay close to our house as I don't want to miss seeing the ambulance which will take daddy to the hospital. His groans ring in my ears, and I can still hear the doctor admitting defeat. Call the ambulance. This time, the doctors will remove a large part of his stomach, and the inhuman sounds which erupt from him at meals will become even more unbearable. Part of me wishes that this time he will die. In the photograph, I gaze at the ground, waiting for the click of the camera, which will release me from this tableau. Family takes oldest daughter to college. My grinning little brother, arms spread wide, stands in front of the rest of us. Daddy, hip to hip with my mother, grips the back of her neck. With his leering, gap-toothed smile, he looks like a hunter displaying fresh kill. My sister looks smugly ahead, like she's already gone. My other brother, more willing to snap the picture than to be part of it, completes his task, and we all move apart. The pained expression on my face remains. I am already married and the mother of two when memories come flooding back to me. Once again, I am 17. Daddy and I are in a hotel room, just the two of us. I wake to find him in the twin bed with me. I push him out and he laughs. Years later, when I confront him, he says, "I was just trying to get warm." After weeks in the ICU, Daddy is moved to a regular room where he repeatedly pulls out the tubes which protrude from nearly every orifice of his frail body. When he is transferred to the hospital unit of a long-term care facility, Daddy tries unsuccessfully to rip off the restraints which keep him from pulling out the tubes. I know he can no longer touch me, but I still stay away from his hands. Daddy is near death, mostly quiet, unable, or maybe unwilling to speak. On one of the last visits before he dies, he bursts out, "Gail, get me a beer." After that, he is quiet, and then he dies. When I was a child, I was not allowed to attend Yisker, the memorial service at our synagogue, where those left behind remember the dead. I always imagined a secret ceremony with spirits hovering near the top of the synagogue's impossibly high domed ceiling. I can feel the presence of dead people. I smell my mother's perfume, and when I look down, I am sure that I see her 9.5 narrow black patent leather shoes. I used to wonder why Daddy wasn't here for Yisker, but now I know. While my mother still resides somewhere within me, Daddy has disappeared. Thank you. And our next reader is Patricia Cannon.
I feel very overwhelmed by Gail Arnoff's piece. Thank you so much for sharing your life experience and how painful it was. And I hope today is a day of joy. And thank you so much for your beautiful writing. And I also want to thank Passenger and Christine Lincoln for creating this space where we can share our stories. So the piece that I'm going to read today was inspired by the deep but complicated love I had for my mentally ill mother. Poetry is the only way I can grasp the fringes of that relationship. A stanza from a poem I wrote about her explains, "Oh, how I yearn to break through the stillness of your ashes, to give you this poem, and to tell you how sorry I am that my love was too fragile to carry the weight of your tears, and that I pray that the infinite hole you felt in your soul, that I now feel in mine, will shortly be filled by the one who has no beginning and no end." Suitcases on Parnassus Street. While strolling along Parnassus Street, two matching purple suitcases left at a bus stop brought me to a halt. One was shut tight, close-mouthed, and standing by a garbage can. Its partner lay a few feet away, open like a gaping mouth, as if it had not only lost all its belongings, but the words it was meant to say. Its metal combination lock no longer turned under the fingers of some unknown traveler. The mysterious luggage brought back memories of when, as a child, I lived on Greyhound buses. The big gray dog on the side of the bus was like a beloved pet. Whenever its slender body, deep chest, and powerful legs arrived at the station, I felt it was my friend welcoming me home. I remember the swishing sound of the bus door opening and the smell of unchanged clothes as I made my way down the aisle with my mother to two empty seats. I always slipped into the space by the window. I loved gazing through the shaded glass at a constantly moving panorama of places and unfulfilled promises while devouring Wonder Bread slices. I ate the white middle and saved the crumbs and the brownish crusts in a plastic bag for later. The recollection is vivid. These curious suitcases had tapped into my need for constant motion, a feeling I had inherited from my mentally ill mother. Before I left them, I took this photo as a souvenir and kept on walking into the sunshine. And now I would like to introduce Janice Zerfas.
This list poem is about both the physical and the psychological items that people carry and that the family carried also. Duffel bags are swelling in the muddy culvert. I'm only reading parts of the poem. The duffel bag leaped up as a trout along the fish ladder. It couldn't stop jiggling. I hid his duffel behind the washing machine where it filled with mice. His was military gray, no camouflage of dying oak leaves falling off the shoulder or trout. I stumbled on the duffel bag's wide berth, a man. He said he could sleep anywhere, and he did, especially a culvert. Not even a doe could scent him out. He was stubborn. He did not have to sleep there. Perhaps he felt safer hiding with migrating birds. His candle lantern kept him company. Sometimes our son and I would take our fishing lures on the pretense of looking for him in the culvert, hoping he wouldn't hide from us. He always said he knew where no one could ever find him, no wife, no son. His duffel bag exploded as a cattail filled with incendiaries and carbon carbide. It is easier to throw carbide at a fish ladder or culvert than a lure or patience. The cot in the basement holds a duffel bag. His forgotten meds are in timed out amber capsules, and this casket is full as the duffel bag. Thank you, passenger. And the next person reading is Karen Hones.
Hello, good afternoon. My name is Karen Hones. And I would like to thank passenger, the editors, and the other writers today, for Lynette for the beautiful cover and the story behind it, and especially Christine Lincoln for your heart and your vision. I'm going to read a short poem, but by introduction, I want to say that 50 years ago, my sister and I took the Greyhound from a small town in Michigan to San Francisco, and we didn't know anybody, but within a week, we had a job and a place to live. We paid $135 a month rent, so that tells you how long ago that was, but what was the most remarkable thing in that early time was that we rather easily assembled a group of friends, and such close friends that they became intentional family over time. And among those were my next door neighbors, who were a couple, Paul and Tom, who we would eat together. We'd go out drinking and dancing. We went to see Elton John, just, you know, had everyday lives. We left our back doors open because we went back and forth between the apartments. And about 10 years after I met them in 82, I unexpectedly became pregnant. And that was also the beginning of the AIDS crisis in San Francisco. And I remember they gave me a baby shower and gave me a, they said, we thought and thought, what will she really need? I was going to be a single mother. And they gave me a washing machine. And then later on, as they became ill, they would come over and do their laundry in my place. But I just, you know, as the face of AIDS changed over time, I thought it was so important to remember them and to remember that time. And both of them did die of AIDS over the, you know, next many years. And so today I'm going to read the poem that's for my friend Tom Sullivan. It's called Dear Friend, I Remember. A typical night at the stud, tall buds, poppers on the dance floor. You threw up the burrito from La Rondalla. Then we linked arms and stumbled home to apartments that were side by side. Later, under a full moon, we sat on the back porch. You said, I want someone to take care of me, just out of earshot of your lover, Paul, who was busy making soup. I see you now as you were then, the most beautiful boy from River Rouge, backlit by moonlight, a beer in one hand, an unfiltered Camel in the other. Already thin, you were soon wasting away like the other young men up and down Castro Street. They called it the gay plague, and if I'd known what was coming, I'd have numbed myself even more. Nothing could be done. You were gone. Alone at home, the back door closed to keep the cat in, I sat on a hard chair at the kitchen table where we used to sit looking out at the coffin factory. Lights went on in the hills. Fog covered the houses, gradually like an erasure. And the next reader will be Carol Clark Williams. Thank you.
This has been so meaningful and so heartbreaking. Listening to stories of parents, the people who brought us into the world and should have loved and protected us, who did us so much damage. And still here we are. We still live. We still hold our heads up and we go forward. My mother had an enormous influence. She told me I was ugly. She told me that she never wanted children. And even in her death from ovarian cancer, her influence continued to echo through my life because I met up with a surgeon who believed that the best way to prevent ovarian cancer was to remove even healthy organs. And that's what happened to me. The title of my poem is Spaying the Kitten, SOP. And as you probably know, SOP means Standard Operating Procedure. To prevent the risks of pregnancy, uterine and breast cancers, I am advised to let them cut her where her purr begins. It will be a small incision because she is small. She will stay overnight hurt in a strange place and come home with what is female removed. I too have been cut vertically with something like a chainsaw, judging by the scar, and everything removed. Though there was no sign of cancer, an ovarian does not usually occur in the appendix, which was also taken. I hold her, trusting, in my hands, rub her stomach where her purr begins. My own gut flinches with a cold, collapsing pain. I am very grateful to be a part of this book. I am thrilled, too, that my Lily, my kitten, will also be a part of this book, and I thank you for letting me read today. Our next reader is Kevin Nance.
Thank you, Carol. I think my poem is, it's about a kind of betrayal. You grow up with a sense of the place that you're from. And that sense that you have in your mind is key to your identity in a lot of ways. And I learned about 3 years ago that my idea of where I grew up, which is Wilmington, North Carolina, was not at all what I thought it was. The reality of the city is much more complicated and much more, there is trauma embedded in the streets of that city in a way that I was never aware of. And I think the fact that I was never taught about this event, this terrible massacre that happened in Wilmington, North Carolina. I never heard a word about it. I think I felt that something important about the place had been kept from me. And I think it's a kind of learning that things you thought were simple are not. So the poem is called Wilmington, and it goes like this. I spent my childhood 30 miles inland, watching the Jim Byrne show on the NBC affiliate and reading the Morning Star. We'd cruise down Ocean Boulevard to Wrightsville Beach, tour the old battleship USS North Carolina, docked forever in the Cape Fear River, eat fried shrimp at Calabash. On family visits in later years, I'd fly through ILM and drive past Laney High, where MJ played JV. It was an airy, innocent place, mini golf in the sun, azaleas in the shade, driveways paved with crushed oyster shells. And never once did I hear a single word about what happened on November 10th, 1898, when Alfred Moore Waddell and a mob of white supremacists armed with rifles and a Gatling gun burned down the Black Daily Record to the ground and then went house to house, killing at least 60 Black people and up to 300. Then staged a coup d'etat, replacing the biracial city council and installing their own mayor, Waddell, who'd vowed never to surrender to a ragged raffle of Negroes, even if we have to choke the Cape Fear River with carcasses. I'm 60 when I learn about the Tulsa massacre from a superhero miniseries on HBO. When I turn 61, my landlord, a historian from New Jersey, tells me about Wilmington. And as he speaks in anger and sorrow, the black and white movie of my youth begins to play again, this time in color. Our next reader is Diane Oatley.
Thank you, Kevin. I don't know if I can even speak. I'm so overwhelmed. I don't know if everybody else can feel what the incredible energy that's being created here. And I really want to thank the editors for the encouragement and the support. These stories are not just difficult to share. They're also difficult to unearth and to dig out and to put onto paper. So you were all very brave, and I thank you all so much for sharing your stories with me. And I'm going to get through this without crying. My essay is entitled Bomb Proof, and it's an excerpt from my memoir, Making Sense, Reflection of a Body in Movement. And I wrote this piece in an attempt to understand the osmosis of unprocessed ancestral trauma and how it is passed on in silence from mother to daughter through the body. And I did this specifically in terms of how it manifested in my own relationship to my mother, who is from Norway. That's a bit of important information if you're going to understand the fragment I will be reading. A year has passed since my elderly mother fell and broke her hip. When I am in Oslo, I visit her regularly, still trying against all odds to crack the good daughter code. Tunneling through the maternal space, I become a covert operative in enemy territory, pocketing the best parts of me for safekeeping. I no longer feel guilt nor shame about this the way I used to as a child or as a young adult. On the contrary, I'm relieved when I understand with an inner bump and tremor that such guerrilla tactics have been necessary. Our relationship has been a battlefield, and she takes no prisoners, shows no mercy, is a head down, no holds barred warrior armed with a hearing aid and a walker.
I suspect that this has always been the case, yet it is only now that I'm able to see it. However much this recognition is cause for celebration, it does not make the experience any less disturbing. All contact with my mother infects me with a skittishly ominous presence. My perceptions become colored by her own as a matter of course. Her anxieties made mine with the same facility of lethal fleas hopping onto my arm from the body of a pet monkey. Though make no mistake, I am the monkey in this story. Through the contamination, myself is tabled. I lose any and all sense of personal desire or preference. The only thing that matters is assuaging her fears, which with an insidious inevitability become my own. On one of my visits, my mother tells me a war story. During the German occupation of Norway in the Second World War, women, the elderly, and children were initially ordered to evacuate Oslo. My mother, who was 12 years old at the time, her brother, and their mother fled to the home of a relative living in the countryside, a few hours north of the city. The train journey was without incident, but no sooner had they arrived and entered the house than the railway tracks were bombed. They dove under the dining room table as all the windows in the house shattered inward, an ice storm of broken glass showering across the floor. When the dust settled, they fled yet again, seeking refuge in a cabin in the mountains. As they were climbing the stony slope, fighter planes dove through the sky, releasing a barrage of gunfire. They cowered behind rocks on the hillside until the fighter planes departed and they could safely continue on their way. My mother has told me this story many times. Every time she tells it, she becomes very sentimental, as if these are cherished memories. This is also true for her stories about the hours spent in the air raid shelter in the basement of her family's apartment building. She speaks fondly of bonds forged between neighbors through the shared trauma of this recurring experience of short-term captivity under siege. I ask her if she feels these experiences have left any emotional scars. She studies me warily, says nothing. I suggest carefully that these experiences might be the cause of her anxiety. She shakes her head. No, she says, I don't have anxiety anymore. This is a lie, and she tells it with a bland complacency, conveniently forgetting her most recent panic attack. Instead, she starts telling the war story again, like a turntable set on automatic repeat. The grooves on this record are deeply entrenched and allow for no meandering into other territories. The walls are secure. The windows of this particular house are bombproof. Thank you. And next up, I'd like to introduce Peter Wallace.
Hi. I just first want to say I'm so grateful to Christine Lincoln and the Passenger team for including me in this group of, as you'll note, almost exclusively women writers. So thank you. I worked for 4 years on a suicide hotline, and this is an excerpt called Ruby Makes a Call from my yet-to-be-published novel, Lifeline, that's about working at the Suicide Hotline Center. This is part of one of the calls. Ruby, in her early 50s, lives in a small town in rural Southern California, where her half-brother half-heartedly tried to commit suicide yesterday, and her father succeeded in killing himself a couple weeks ago. The door slaps loudly behind her. She puts her cigarette butt in the trash. The cold crowds her shoulders. Ruby, can we talk about you for a second? What about me? The dishes need doing. Well, your brother is a drinker and a gambler. My guess is your father drank quite a bit. Oh, he was an alcoholic, definitely. I'm just grateful none of my kids picked it up, from their father especially. Well, have you heard of Al-Anon? You mean AA? Of course I have. I don't need them. I don't drink. No, Al-Anon is for family members of alcoholics. It's just a way to get together with people who know a bit of what you're going through. I mean, there'll be people who have people who've committed suicide and how they're dealing with that. You know, someone you can talk to and someone you don't have to see afterwards if you don't want to and you don't have to pay. Ruby thinks, who I'd really like to talk to is Teddy, named Theodora by Ruby's useless husband after his own grandmother. But Teddy is what stuck. She'd like to go for a walk along the river with her and find out what all this lesbian business is about. It's not that she minds particularly. It's just that it took Teddy away and she misses her like a lost limb. It's in Wolford Heights, the phone man is saying, every Wednesday night at 7, Fellowship Hall. I know that place. Will you consider it? I guess. She didn't want to do the dishes anymore. Too many things to do. As far as your brother goes, well, have him call here. But if you think he's in any danger, just get him to the closest emergency room. Just pile him in the car and go. You can do that? Just go. The house seems dark, cold. Just her and Lucian now. In a few years, who knows? Just her. She suddenly seems surrounded by them all. Her mom, for some goddamn reason. Her grandparents. Ladies from the town before the town was flooded out and moved. Hungry, weary settlers who tried to pass through and stayed. Old gold miners. Paiutes or something, she can't tell. Also, Mexicans before Mexico, crowding into the house from outside, coming in the back door, the front door, a few coming out of Teddy's room, passing the time of day and ignoring her, ignoring everything, even walls and windows. It's kind of scaring the shit out of her. This is a lot more than usual. Sobs start coming out of her throat, unbidden, like keening frogs. The place becomes stuffy until she's choking, losing all breath. So she manages to open the front door against the thickness of the room, almost dropping the phone. She goes down the few steps to the dirt walk and looks up at the one palm tree someone planted 50 years ago that should have died but keeps on growing in a foreign land, shedding fronds and reaching for the sky, making her yearn to breathe and touch what it's reaching for. She's going to go there. I'll call you back, she says. And Diane Fusting is next, reading from her poetry.
Hello, everyone. First of all, I just have to say I am in complete awe of the bravery and just astonishing talent of everyone here. Thank you, passenger editors. Kendra, Mary, Christine, Roseanne, I'm new to all of this, but you've instilled in me a faith that editors are in fact human. John Shore, who just this week helped me learn, I should say, the difference between hearing a poem read and reading a poem on a page. So thank you, John. Lynette, after hearing your explanation of your cover, I almost fell off my chair. Just absolutely beautiful. And then Chris Lincoln. I just started writing poetry about a year ago and I told a friend about it. And she said, you really should check out Passenger. It's a wonderful journal. And I thought, okay. So I clicked on, went to the site and I clicked on submissions and there was Chris Lincoln with her video. And I probably listened to it or played it over 4 or 5 times. And I thought, okay, I think she gets me, maybe. And I'm going to go ahead and submit. So the poem, My Vagus Nerve Needs a Somatic Butterfly Hug, is, and actually Chris's video made me think, how do we heal? Like, how do we really heal from whatever, all the things that people have shared today? And while I was thinking that, I'm getting all these emails. My inbox is flooded with invitations to online trauma summits. And I thought, okay, so I went to some of those. And the question still remained to me, how do we heal? And ultimately, for me, this poem is my attempt to answer that question. So my vagus nerve needs a somatic butterfly hug. If I am invited to one more online trauma summit, I may have a nervous breakdown. During this summit, you will receive access to 50 plus leading therapists, scientists, researchers, activists, poets, artists, and visionaries who are at the forefront of this emerging movement. Each of the 9 days will include 4 to 5 new talks, which you can listen to free for 48 hours or for $197. You can upgrade for lifetime access to reliving all the shit that life has thrown your way. My body has kept score, calculating the tally and tolls,
an emotional spreadsheet of abuse, abandonment, neglect, addiction, misogyny. All without visible bruises or bite marks that might have triggered my own personal summit of protection. So please don't read me another poem or explain how I need to form new neuropathways to peace and acceptance. Please do not make pain science and science painful. Just come sit with me, hold my hand, and let me scream and cry and tell you where and how it hurts. And when I'm finished, you can do the same. And we will sit there together in the sweet puddle of our shared grief, silently recognizing each other in a true emerging movement of collective healing that will taste like honey. Thank you. And I'm happy to introduce to you Moira Magneson reading her wonderful poem, I Am.
Hi, everybody. Thank you, Diana. I love the ending of that poem very much. It's hopeful. And I too got to Passenger because of Christine Lincoln's video that was, I also watched it over and over and I was like, I gotta submit. So yeah, that was awesome. Anyway, it's wonderful to read with such fine storytellers and poets. And I'm grateful to Chris Lincoln for plucking this poem out of the original really raggedy batch of poems. And thanks to the Passenger staff and Lynette, the cover artist, for this gorgeous, really gripping issue. This poem, I Am, is a response to cumulative and largely unacknowledged family damage wrought over generations. And it made itself known during the front end of the pandemic when we were all experiencing so much uncertainty and fear, which magnified so many of our family stories. I think a lot of us probably felt that. And I was a bit reluctant to title the poem I Am because it sounds really egotistical, but then I remembered the British romantic poet John Clare. He has a poem titled I Am, about his own darkness and mental health struggles. And I thought, if he can do it, I can too. So the poem is also homage to John Clare. I am ready to evanesce once and for all from the mess of family, of form, the body's blunder, the mind's unceasing thunder. Surrender the scissors once I cut myself out of the frame, possess nothing, not even air. Step out of my name. And our next reader is poet Nancy Naomi Carlson. Take it away.
Thank you, Moira, and thank you for that beautiful I Am poem. And thank you to all the readers. There's such a sense of healing and trauma and sharing, and we can't help but cry at this. And Christine has put together an issue that brings all kinds of trauma to us. And in my day job, I train clinical mental health counselors and school counselors. So I get my share of it, and I get my share of counselors in training. And it's not at a level of depth unless there are tears. So I hope everyone feels it's a safe space to feel this. And it's almost a sacred space. Thank you to the Passenger, Kendra, and the team for bringing this to us. And I'm going to read a villanelle. It's only got 19 lines. I'm the next to the last reader, so you're probably glad it's 19 lines. It follows a pattern, rhyming pattern, repetition of two lines interchanging. And I think I was drawn to the form because when you have things that you want to share that are traumatic, and that's what brought me to poetry. I had lost a baby the day he was born. And it was only till 20 years later that I started writing and dedicating a book to the baby. Since then, I've gotten more trauma, cancer coming in, the pandemic. There's just so much. And if you can hide some of it behind form, because that holds you in but lets you emote. And villanelles are forms that allow you to do that. And when you then have an epigraph to Samuel Beckett, so you're bringing in another layer, protecting you a little bit, which allows you to go deeper. And Samuel Beckett wrote plays of the theater of the absurd. And one of his plays is Happy Days, where the main character is buried up to her waist in sand, talking to her partner. And that's act one. And act two, she's buried up to her neck in sand, and she's still talking and still talking about the next day. So my villanelle begins with an epigraph from Samuel Beckett. Sort of, it mentions him. It's called Phantom Pain, after a line by Samuel Beckett. Every loss recalls another loss, eroding more of you, a brine lash cave. The end is in the beginning, yet we go on. Grief springs out of sofas, credenzas, and drawers. Masking and distance can't stop the ache. Every loss recalls another loss, like delving inside a wooden nesting doll. The hard-to-open smallest reveals hollowed space. The end is in the beginning. We go on despite the empty chairs and beds the way they'd want us to. To hell with booby-trapped DNA. Every loss recalls another loss. Cut out the troubled cells. Offer a leg or an arm or even two, you'll still feel the phantom pain. The end is in the beginning. Going on, we learn to patiently sift through day-to-day dross for the words to define the end game. Every loss recalls another loss. The end is in the beginning. Go on. And now it's my honor to introduce our last reader, Kelly Madigan. Thank you.
Thank you. So happy to be here and to hear all of your words. I have a genius of a best friend, and this poem could never have happened without her. So I'll give you a little bit of background. When my friend of over 40 years invited me to a baby shower for her grandmother, long dead, she had my attention. In the process of healing her own trauma, she had come to see her grandmother in a new light. Reaching backward in time, the ceremony she thought to perform was to offer a baby shower to the woman who would not have been given one as an unmarried pregnant woman in those times. This is the poem that came, my gift to Iva. And I want to say that Iva's granddaughter, my friend Cindy, is in the audience today. And I want to say that it was meaningful to me that an earlier reader, Karen, mentioned her baby shower and the washing machine gift that she received. And I also want to say that I believe that not only is Iva's granddaughter here, but I think Iva must be here as well. Retroactive baby shower for Iva. It begins with an epigraph from A Course in Miracles. Let miracles replace all grievances. The baby of the baby of the woman reaches back, herself now grown, and adjusts the lens. We till up the past in cycles, and by turning and turning, something new is lifted up from the mired relation. An attempt to imprison the divine feminine, to own and control her mysterious sexuality, has imprisoned all who pass, the man and woman rooted together in the dark, the newborn passing into light and already engulfed in darkness, the pious poisoned by their own food, choking on the unstoppable desire of creation to live, to be born. Today, as a shower game, we burn the Bibles. We throw open the monastery doors, the convents, and homes for the unwed, where these uncontrollable wild women were banished. Iva, your beautiful body did exactly as it was designed to do. Rolling in the deep intoxication, growing this marvelous child, and we celebrate. Cast aside any lingering backwards ideas. Your baby is coming. Here are the tiny outfits, the carriage, the pacifier. Here are the diapers, washed and sun-dried, carefully folded. They are whiter than white, unmarked, new, as you are, as you are. Earlier, Diana said in her poem to just come sit with me. And so I want to thank everyone who came today as listeners, who came and sat with us and listened. And with that, I'd like to turn this back over to Kendra. Thank you.
Thank you all. This was marvelous, marvelous. To hear you speak your own story and your own true story. Remarkable. While you're thinking of your question or comment, Chris, do you want to jump in and say something?
No. I really don't want to say anything. Your word. I just want your words. That's what I've always wanted for this. I wanted your words and your hearts to be the primary source of life for this journal. And you keep saying, I did this, I did not do this. You all did this. You did this. So thank you from the bottom of my heart. I've been changed. I'm not the same person that I was before this. I mean, my life is not the same at all. I have been profoundly changed. I wish I could sit and have coffee with you all and tell you all the ways that I'm different. I'm not the same person. So thank you.
I have one quick comment. Thank you all. As Christina said, I feel changed. Something has shifted, and I'm so grateful for your words, your spirit, your soul, your honesty, all of it. And it made me think, oh gosh, how powerful it is for us. I'm thinking of a poem my friend Lasana Bell Harvey wrote. It's called The Well, and he said, the villagers come to the well and pour things. And how this outpouring, I feel so much a community. I feel the truth
and the allness of what that really, really means today. This is what it means to be in community. So I hope to be at the well with you all again. Thank you.
I would like to just comment on a few people said it in the chat, but I wanted to comment openly to the men that were present today. With being in, you know, a reading of mostly women and to hear those male voices. We live in a patriarchal society still, but to know that men deal with trauma too. And although it's more hidden and it's disguised in other ways in society, to hear those readings just, I'm raising a son. So it just made me think about all of the traumas that men can hide and we never get to hear. So thank you both for just being a part of this today. And to everyone else as well, like Christine said, I just don't know how you can be in this space and not be changed. It's impossible to hear the collection and the community of this and just not leave a different person today. I know that I will, and I have, and it'll probably take me a few weeks to process all that has happened today.
Mm-hmm. The experience of writing your story, I was curious how you felt, if it felt like a door closing or a door opening. Interpret that how you want, if you want to. It's just an open-ended question.
Christine, I'd like to answer that. I feel like it's a little of both. Mm-hmm. You know, for me, it closes the door of being the victim and it opens the door to being a victor. Because I think once we revisit and understand and give something breath and get in those dark spaces, we begin to heal. And I think that through writing my trauma, it's enabled me to live a life of peace.
I was just kind of thinking about, as we were all talking, you know, it really reminds me, those who have ever gone into Buddhism, playing Buddhism, the parable of the mustard seed, where the Buddha is talking with a woman who comes to him because she's grieving and she can't get over the death of her child. And he says, well, I know how to fix this. Go into the village and bring me a mustard seed from the home of one who has never known death. And she goes to every home in the house. And eventually, after days, she comes back and she says, I can't find it. There is no home. And he said, that's right. That's where we all come together.
That was really, I wanted to dispel the notion that we have to walk through trauma and process this stuff on our own. We really are. There's only one of us here in this world. There aren't 8 billion people. There's one of us here. And I really wanted to touch on that. I don't use the words, you'll never hear me say that was brave, only because I want to get rid of the idea that we have to be brave in order to share our pain, that we have to have all this courage. I want to normalize this. I want somebody to be able to say, how are you doing? And the person to say, I am struggling. I'm suffering. My child has mental illness. I'm hurting. Can you hold my hand and let me scream with you? And we not say, oh, how brave of you, but yes, give me your hand and scream and I'll cry with you, right? Like that's, yeah, we are not alone. This is all of us. This is all of us.
When you were writing your pieces, did other traumas or moments in your life start raising their hand, asking for your attention? Did you feel like it was leading you into
trauma? I'd like to jump in there and respond to that. And I'm, you know, the trauma that I wrote about in my poem wasn't mine. You know, it was Cindy's and Iva's, and yet it's such a universal story. But what I thought about was how many past events need a ceremony like that? Like, is that applicable to other, you know, things that went wrong, you know, things that were handled poorly, the traumas that happened, you know, people acting terrible? And, you know, is there a way to, you know, whatever it is, throw the birthday party, you know, throw the baby shower, you know, give somebody the divorce they should have had? what other, you know, just that idea of those sort of magical retroactive ceremonies seems like something worth taking forward.
Mm-hmm. It's like a splinter in the brain. And if you don't get it out, you got two choices. You know, you get a splinter, you either get a cyst around it or you have an infection, but it never goes away. And until you get it out, it's always stuck. And that's what PTSD is. And writing, I've always found, is such an amazing way of giving, and especially because if it's something you don't want to say yet, but you can write it and burn it, you can get it out. Nobody has to see it, but you can still pull it out in privacy. And then, or you can make it pretty, or you can read it to somebody, or you could just bury it in a hole. But at least you're pulling out that splinter.
We are so blessed to be able to write, to be able to write it down. Not only can you sometimes rewrite something to give it the ending you would have preferred, but you also meet people who are invested in writing and exploring their lives the same way you are. And then you have this wonderful circle of friends who are a blessing in themselves because you share in your writings.
So I guess we'll close. We'll say goodbye. Lovely, lovely, powerful, moving, heart-wrenching reading. You all did a beautiful job.